I would like to thank Minister Soloway for her presentation and her passionate defence of research culture. Vitae has been collating input from the community to feed into the R&D roadmap, and we hope that there will be opportunities to connect again in the future. We will now move to our second keynote speaker, Professor Dame Ottoline Laser, Chief Executive of UK Research and Innovation, UKRI. Prior to joining UKRI, Ottoline Laser was Professor of Plant Development at the University of Cambridge and Director of the Sainsbury Laboratory. She was appointed DBA for her services to plant science, science and society, and equality and diversity. And Ottoline is widely recognised for her long-term interest in research culture. We're really excited that we're one of her first speaking engagements since she's taken up this influential role in June. Ottoline, over to you.
Thank you very much. It's a real pleasure to be here. I've worked with Vitae for many years and it's great to be here with a new hat and hopefully the opportunity really to move forward on some of the agendas I've been really passionate about for a long time, particularly in the context of what's going on in government. You'll have heard from Minister Soloway her real passion and commitment to this issue in the context of a protected, indeed increasing science budget. So I think we're in an extraordinary position really to move forward despite, and maybe even perhaps because of all the challenges of the disruptions that are going on globally in the research community, driven obviously by the COVID pandemic. So I have some slides, which I will try and share with you. Oops. I hope you can see that. So I want to talk about the same kinds of areas that Minister Soloway has just talked about, but I want to do it in a more zoomed out way, because I think for me, a lot of the issues that we face as a community, and particularly in the context of early career researchers, is almost a misconception of what the research and innovation system is like, what's in it and what's out of it and how it works. And I think we have to use this reframing opportunity that has come about from the global crisis we're currently facing to reimagine, to redescribe how we consider the research and innovation system and therefore our opportunities to make it work so much better than it currently does. So just a little bit of background on UKRI, UK Research and Innovation. It's a relatively new organisation. It's the largest public funder of research and innovation in the UK, and it was formed a couple of years ago by bringing together 9 separate organisations, which is 7 disciplinary research councils, Innovate UK, which focuses on innovation and the business community, and Research England, which focuses on the university sector. And so we have this extraordinary breadth and depth of expertise within the organisation across disciplines and across sectors in the research community, which I think gives us an extraordinary opportunity to think in this much more holistic way that I am going to try to convince you is what we have to do. We are, of course, accountable to government because we're spending a large amount of taxpayers' money. And for me, the key is to develop these really deep partnerships across the system, in academia, of course, but in business, in government, the wider public sector, the third sector, and crucially, internationally. And now my slides have decided not to advance when I ask them to. Oop, there we go. Now they'll probably advance in 3 rapid goes because I pressed the button several times, but we'll see what happens. Okay, so as I said, UKRI is an extraordinary organisation in its breadth and depth of reach across the system. And I think this gives us the opportunity to really to think about the system and how it should be working. And for me, what we have to do is build this creative, dynamic research and innovation system in which anyone can participate and from which everyone benefits. We have to break down the idea that there is a barrier between science and the wider research community and everyone else. This has got to be a system for everyone, by everyone, and for everyone. And we have the opportunity to do this precisely because, as I said, we reach right across the community and have these very strong relationships that we can build further with the key stakeholders that I've mentioned. And this gives us the opportunity then to steward the system, to steer it into a place where it is connected and embedded in our culture and can drive the kind of rebuilding of our economy post-COVID that we need. There's a lot of discussion about the knowledge economy as the way forward. We have to make very sure that the knowledge economy works for everyone, that it's an inclusive knowledge economy and with an inclusive research and innovation system at its core. So UKRI, through its reach across the whole system, has the opportunity to use a whole variety of levers to try to get to that place that we want to be. So we can convene and catalyze, we can bring people together in different permutations and combinations and catalyze new activities through the work that we do, but also through the engagement that we have with key stakeholders. And of course, we can incentivize through a whole variety of approaches the behaviors of the system that we think are really important. And that obviously involves what we fund, but crucially also the incentive structures in the system that drive the choices people make are key to shifting the culture into a much more engaged and holistic space. And as a funder, we also actually conduct directly quite a lot of research. We have research institutes and research facilities that we fund research directly. And of course, if we're anything we say about the system has got to apply to the work that we do ourselves in those centres. So for me, as Minister Soloway said, a key part of this vision is about people. And a key problem we have in the system is the current conceptualization of what research and innovation is about. And those two things are critically locked together. I think it's our conception of what a researcher is that is quite central to a lot of the problems that we're facing. We tend to think of researchers as these lone geniuses beavering away in their ivory towers, discovering great things. And that creates all kinds of problems. The key ones to me are a separation between the research system and the rest of the world, which is disastrous for all kinds of reasons. It makes it very difficult for all kinds of different people to come into the system, and it makes it very difficult for ideas to get out of the system and diffuse into the economy. If you think of it in that in and out way, driven by the lone genius, and it puts all kinds of very problematic pressures on the so-called lone geniuses. They're having to deliver in this model of Einstein, and it is incredibly unhelpful to their well-being, but also to the success and creativity of the research system, because very little research happens in that lone genius way. Pretty much all of it is part of a much wider and collaborative activity. So when you start to talk about that, people think about, you know, small research teams, and they expand a little bit further out from that. But I think we need to go much further and expand to think about the entire endeavor, the entire research endeavor, which goes way beyond the people who are actively and directly conducting the research. None of us can work without a much wider network of support people, including the people on this call, who help us all to do the research and innovation that we are striving to do. And that is absolutely the people in the labs, but much more broadly, the archivists and librarians, the people making the IT systems work, the people running the big facilities that we need for our experiments and research. And of course, the HR people, the administrators, the project managers, and the people developing the skills of the researchers and the innovators, such as the people, as I say, on this call. It's a big system. There are a lot of people, and they are all critical for a healthy research and innovation system. And until we start really thinking about this much wider community as being a key part of the system, then I think we will continue both to create barriers for all kinds of people coming in because they don't think they're an Einstein, so why would they even think about the research system? And it will make life very difficult for the researchers in the system because they will feel it's all down to them when obviously it isn't. So to create the kinds of much more connected system that we need to feed people right into it across that range of activities in the system, then we need our key research organizations to be deeply networked in the communities that create both the flow of people and ideas through the system, out of the education system, for example, and into the much wider economy. So we have to think about where these research organizations fit in the context of schools, further education, higher education, and where then, how the people come into the system and how they move through the system. And it is all about people. It's all about empowering people to think of themselves as part of this much broader collaborative system and to find their path through it that both meets their aspirations and needs as an individual, but also contributes to joining up the system in a way that really allows it to thrive as a creative research and innovation endeavor. And so we have to think not only about the networking of the system with, for example, the education community, but also the networking of the many different places in our society where research and innovation happens. It's universities, it's small companies, it's big companies, it's public sector laboratories. Right across the system, there are many places where research and innovation is happening, and it is critical that people and ideas move between these, because it is through the flow of people and ideas that we join up the different parts of the system and allow, for example, the really basic, innovative discoveries to make it into the real world and deliver benefits to our society, both in the context of business and the economy, but also in the context of improving public services and so on and so forth. It is all about collaboration, and we need to establish within the community this idea of a collective endeavor, a shared responsibility to build a system that works for everyone and includes everyone, so that we're not looking at a separate research and innovation system that is somehow delivering magic bullets to solve societal problems, but rather we're looking at a shared endeavor nationally and internationally, so that we can harness the power of creativity and innovation to solve some of the very many problems that we're facing collectively around the world. And a good way to think about this as a public funder of research, and as has been mentioned already, so we have this tendency to think about research in the context of ideas and products. So we think about the discoveries and the things that they can turn into, and we tend to think of it as a linear pathway between one and the other. And we tend both to fund and reward those activities. So we think discoveries make papers, products make companies, and there's patents and those kinds of things. And what we need to do as a funder is to invest in those things. I think this is a fundamentally flawed way of looking at the system. We will not generate that flow through of ideas through the system unless we think about the whole system and crucially the people in it and how they move through the system. This is a big connected system. It is currently inadequately connected, and we need to fund directly connectivity. And that means substantially people. It means because the ideas move mostly through the system on legs, as it has been described. An individual researcher starting their career and research training in one particular place and moving through the research system through their career will take with them their knowledge, their skills, their ideas, their experience, and their networks of people they know. And it is that very human element that joins the system up in a way that makes it work effectively. And unless we think about the system in this way and think about how we invest in this way, then I think we will continue to face this gap between fundamental research and its real world impacts that we struggle in a lot of places to fill. And more importantly, I think we will continue to face this gap between the concept of research and innovation and the society that it serves. And both of those gaps we need to plug, and a key way to plug them is through thinking about the people in the system. So your role as developers of those people, to my mind, is key to oiling the wheels, to fueling this integrated system that I think we have to work hard to achieve as we try to build back better after the shock of the coronavirus system. That inclusive knowledge economy is crucially dependent on this connectivity, and the connectivity is crucially dependent on how we incentivize and fund and develop and train and enable all of the different kinds of people in this system. And this is true locally, it's true nationally, and it's true globally. People will move globally, and through their global movement will network internationally as well. And the power of science diplomacy in addressing some of these global challenges, including building really strong relationships between countries, I think is crucial. So we have many things that I think we need to do in order to build this connected system. And I mentioned at the beginning that UKRI, in its position as a key national funder, has a lot of levers that it can put into the system to catalyze this kind of activity. And as Amanda mentioned, it's about what we fund and how we fund it, but it is also about the incentives in the system that we use to drive behaviors. And I'm very excited about working closely with Minister Soloway on some of these initiatives associated with the people and culture strategy in the roadmap, where we really have the opportunity to shift those incentives to value a much wider range of inputs into the system, and to recognize diversity in the system, diversity of contributions, diversity of skills, and diversity of talents, because without that diversity, the system simply will not work. So I'm very pleased to be able to speak to this audience, because as I've said, I think your role is key in fueling this increased connectivity in the system, and in helping to develop people who will move in that empowered way through the system, taking their ideas and skills with them, and really driving the connectivity that we need to solve the world's current challenges. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Ottoline.